Greetings of the day. I welcome you all to second lecture on power quality problems and solutions. In our previous lecture, I gave you an overview of a power system. We drew simplified structure of an electrical power system, and we defined various voltage levels like generation power, voltage level at generation, power generation, voltage level at power transmission, voltage level at sub-transmission, and then distribution level, voltage levels. We discussed these voltage levels in Indian power system scenario also. And I told you that modern power systems are very complex networks because hundreds and hundreds of generators, generating stations and load centers, they are connected, interconnected to, with each other through long, high voltage, long transmission lines. And we also learned that for reliable operation of the system, for continuous power supply delivery to the consumers, all the components of power system have to operate reliably and stably. Now, what are the various components? Generation, power transmission, power distribution, in addition to power utilization. Then I gave you an idea about the fact that a few years back, reliability was the only concern of most of the consumers. And a system was said to be reliable if it gives continuous power supply. A system these days also is said to be reliable if it delivers continuous interruption-free power supply. And then I told you that a transmission system is exposed to forces of Mother Nature, and there may be faults, there may be short circuits, and there because of windstorm, because of lightning strike, there may be problems, and power disruption may take place, and that may affect the reliability of the system. And I told you that in most advanced countries, the generation system is highly reliable, but distribution system is not reliable. It's not as reliable as generation system. Then for a high reliability, you have to have very robust, very strong protection system, maintenance schedules, and other factors have to be taken into consideration. I also told you that nowadays, it's not only reliability which is demanded by the customers. In addition to highly reliable power supply, the customers also demand a good quality of power supply. Then we defined the term power quality. Okay, we said that power quality has something to do with maintaining sinusoidal waveform of bus voltages and currents, and maintaining their magnitude and frequency constant. If it is so, then we have a good, very good power supply. If there are no voltage sags, voltage dips, there is no harmonic distortion, there are no voltage swells, there are no notches, there are no harmonics, okay, then and there is a very less reliable, this reactive power flowing in the system, then the system delivers a good power quality. The power quality is said to be good. However, I told you that the consumers may not receive a good quality of power. I gave you an example that, let us suppose a sensitive equipment, a critical equipment like a hospital load or industrial processing load, say semiconductor manufacturing or semiconductor processing unit or food processing unit or rayon, etc., they may be connected or they may be fed from the same bus which feeds a large motor. Okay, then these sensitive loads or critical loads, they are going to face severe voltage sags or severe voltage dips whenever this large motor is directly started on this line, because of huge starting current, and hence this voltage dips. I also told you that these voltage dips may result in maloperation of patient care equipment, very sensitive equipment like ventilators, life support systems, operation theaters, and patient database system. Data from the patient database system may get erased because of these voltage dips. I also told you that in case of a semiconductor manufacturing plant, a complete batch of semiconductor products which is under the manufacturing process, it may get damaged, may get ruined because of these voltage sags. I also told you that in a food processing unit, okay, when the food processing takes place, a lot of raw material is under process and food processing is taking place, a voltage dip of a very short duration can ruin the entire food processing system, and the whole raw material will get wasted. And it has been observed that in countries like USA, Europe and other countries, these voltage dips result in a huge loss of revenue worth millions of dollars every year. Okay, then I told you that because of this, the customers demand a very good quality of the power. The power quality should be very good, and I defined this term power quality. I told you that power quality is not a new term. It was first of all used in literature in the year 1968, and then from 1969 to 1984, INSPEC database contains about 91 records where the term power quality is mentioned. So electric utilities have been trying for decades to improve the power quality of the power systems. But say, let us say 20 or 30 years back or 40 years back, this power quality issue was not a main concern. Reliability was main concern. But nowadays, in addition to reliability, this power quality issue is a burning issue. It's a main concern of the electrical engineers. And with the widespread proliferation of power electronics in our systems, electrical system, see, whether it is generation or transmission or distribution or utilization, you everywhere use power electronics. Power electronics has entered in all spheres of our lives. You can find power electronics in your drawing rooms. You can find power electronics in your bedrooms, in your kitchens, in your bathrooms. I mean, domestic loads, commercial loads, industrial loads, everywhere, even transportation, aircrafts, ships, military equipment, everywhere we use power electronics based equipments. Because power electronics has brought a second revolution after industrial revolution. It's a revolution, of course, it's a revolution. Power electronics has brought a revolution. And power electronics based equipments we find everywhere. Now, because of widespread use of these power electronics based equipments, a lot of problems have occurred. See, one is the bright side of the technology and another is the dark side of the technology. When you are taught power electronics in your BTech course, or maybe advanced power electronics or applied power electronics in your MTech course, we teach only the bright side of the technology. But this power electronics technology, like other technologies, has a dark side also. What is the dark side? The power electronic converters, when they operate, and there is a flooding of power electronic converters, huge number of power electronics converters, when they are fed from a bus, they cause harmonic injection in the currents. They distort the voltages, bus voltages, and they create a lot of problems to other equipments. One of the students had put a query on the group today that is it only the customer load which is responsible for power quality issues, or utility? See, it is the joint responsibility of utility as well as customers and also manufacturers of the equipments to maintain a good power quality. See, if you take utility and consumers, let's forget about manufacturers of the equipments, it's the joint responsibility of both utility and consumers or customers to ensure a good power quality. But it is the consumer which is mainly responsible for creating various types of power quality problems. We'll come to know about it progressively in a phased manner as we progress in our course. We have started module 1 just in our previous lecture yesterday. So we will learn about how consumer loads are responsible for many power quality issues. And we divide our loads into industrial loads, commercial loads and residential loads. And all these types of loads should get a very good quality of the power. Now, what is actually a power quality problem? And what are the factors, or what are the various types of power quality problems, and what causes these power quality problems, and what is the impact of power quality problems on the end user, that is consumer equipment. See, power quality hits everybody. Power quality does not hit consumer alone, it hits the utility also, it hits the manufacturer also. One example is, if power quality problem is there, the consumer equipment, for example, you go to market, you purchase a branded motor from some company, say you purchase a motor from ABB. ABB motors are very good motors. They are considered very good, highly efficient, noise-free, very good motors. And whenever you connect your motor to the supply, your motor starts giving problems. Problems like starts operating with a lot of noise, there are torque pulsations, there is heating in the motor coils, motor winding, and other problems. As a layman, who will you blame? You will immediately start blaming the company, ABB. And you will say that the company has not manufactured a good quality of motor. But that's not true. Why your motor is behaving like this? Reason may be power quality. Because the voltage that you are applying across the terminals of your motor, that voltage may be full of harmonics. When ABB designs the motor, it designs the motor with the assumption that it has to be powered through a purely sinusoidal source. But if your source is not sinusoidal, if it is distorted, it has a lot of harmonics, then what will the company do? Company cannot do anything. Your motor will start malfunctioning, maloperating, and it will start giving problems to you. And in that case, you cannot blame the manufacturer. But as a layman, as an engineer, I know that it is the power quality issue. But a layman does not know anything about power quality. He immediately starts blaming the company. He lodges complaints against the company, and he tells his other friends also that please don't purchase motor from ABB. Their motors are very bad, this and that. And that affects the brand name of the company. So it is not only the consumer who suffers, whose load suffers. It is the manufacturer also, who for no reason also suffers. His brand name, you know, becomes, there is problem with its name. The consumer starts blaming the manufacturer. And it hits equally the utility. Because you start blaming the utility for these power quality problems without knowing that my load or other consumer's load has caused these harmonic distortions. So, all the three players in this game, who are the three players in this game? Utility, manufacturer, and consumer. All the three suffer because of these power quality problems. And therefore, you have to search for solutions to these power quality problems. That's how this subject has come into picture. Some 10 years, 15 years back, this subject was not taught at master's levels in electrical engineering. Okay, some idea was given to the students, but it is an integral part of your course. Whether you belong to electric power and energy systems, MTech specialization, or power electronics and electric drives, MTech specialization. You can see this power quality course is a core course. In all reputed engineering universities all over the world, this course is taught at PG level. Okay. And in some foreign universities, there are separate research labs and departments which are dedicated to research on power quality. In India also, like in IIT Roorkee, where from I got my M.Tech and Ph.D., they have a dedicated lab for power quality. They call it Power Quality Lab. And this lab was created immediately after I completed my Ph.D. in the year 2008 under Science and Technology Initiative. Okay, so in IITs, many IITs and NITs, and all over the world in reputed engineering universities, power quality research labs are already established, and a lot of research is going on in this area. It's a hot area, it's a burning issue. So therefore, researchers as well as industries, they are working jointly towards resolving these power quality issues, power quality problems. These issues have become very prominent because our loads nowadays, they are very sensitive to these power quality problems. For example, nowadays you use let us say medical equipments are purely electronic equipments, and those electronic equipments or medical equipments are very sensitive to voltage fluctuations, voltage dips, voltage sags, voltage swells and harmonics. Similarly, in industries we use adjustable speed drives, which are variable frequency in inverter fed induction motor drives. They are also very sensitive to voltage variations, voltage sags, voltage interruptions and harmonics. Our load has become very sensitive to these voltage related problems. 30 or 40 years back, our load was not sensitive to, even if these problems were there, but our load was not sensitive to these problems. But nowadays we have the electronic equipments, power electronic based equipments or loads, which are very sensitive to these problems. So that's why we need to understand these problems and address the issue, try to solve these problems, provide the solutions to various power quality problems. Let us try to define power quality problem first. I will write here power quality problem. What is a power quality problem? It is called power quality problem. Another name is also called, it's also called power quality phenomenon. Or it is also called power quality disturbance. You can see, if you search the literature, different names are given to it. It's called power quality problem. And literature also calls it power quality phenomenon, or some literature calls it power quality disturbance. But the most common name is power quality problem. How do we define power quality problem? Let me give you the definition of power quality problem. Power quality problem is an occurrence manifested in non-standard voltage, current and frequency variations, which lead to or which result in misoperation and or failure of the end equipment. Let me write it. A power quality problem is an occurrence manifested as non-standard voltage, current or frequency deviations that lead to misoperation or failure of end use equipment. This is the definition, a standard definition of power quality problem. There may be your voltage may be a non-standard voltage. Non-standard voltage may be, it means it is full of harmonics. There are sags, means dips, there are swells, there are fluctuations in the voltage. So it is non-standard voltage. Similarly, you may have non-standard current, and you may have frequency deviations also. Frequency may not be constant. That's also a power quality issue. And these non-standard voltage, current or frequency deviations, what will they result in? They will result in misoperation or maloperation of your end user equipment, and in some cases they may result even in the failure of the end user equipment. That is the definition of power quality problem. So what are the various types of power quality problems? But before we discuss various types of power quality problems, let us try to understand briefly what is the impact of various power quality problems on consumers, on end user equipment. I will write here impact of, from now onwards I will not write power quality, I will use PQ. PQ means power quality. Impact of power quality problems on end users, on end users. So let me discuss with you briefly the impact of various types of power quality problems on the end user equipment or on the end user. First of all, you have to identify various types of power quality problems. And one by one, then you have to discuss what is the impact of each power quality problem on the end users. So various types of power quality problems, briefly I can mention here. First type of power quality problem that we are going to discuss is impulsive transients. That is first, transients I will write here. Let me not write impulsive transients. The first type of power quality problem that is generally encountered in power systems is transients. And there are two types of transients, impulsive transients and oscillatory transients. I will come to that later on. So that is first. Second is short duration voltage variations. Short duration voltage variations. There is a voltage variation means there may be a dip in the voltage, or there may be a swell. Swell means increase in the voltage, or there may be a temporary interruption in the voltage. Interruption means voltage has become zero, maybe temporarily for a few seconds. So such variations are called short duration voltage variations. Dip is there, voltage sag is there, but short duration voltage sag, maybe for a few cycles, one or two or three cycles. Similarly, voltage swell may be there for a few cycles. And similarly, you may face voltage interruptions, again for a few cycles. So they are called short duration voltage variations. What are the effects of these short duration voltage variations on consumer loads? We'll discuss that. And then third type of power quality problem whose impact we are going to study on end user equipment is long duration voltage variations. Long duration voltage variations. One is short duration voltage variations, another is long duration voltage variations. Long duration voltage variation means under voltage. Under voltage is actually a voltage dip, but a long duration voltage dip. It's called under voltage. If it's a short duration drop in the voltage, then it's called voltage sag or voltage dip. But if the voltage drop is for longer duration, it's called under voltage. So under voltage, over voltage, and sustained interruption. One is temporary interruption. Another is sustained interruption. Sustained interruption may be there for many seconds to many minutes or maybe hours. Okay, we will study the impact of long duration voltage variations on the end users. The next is waveform distortions. Waveform distortions. Your waveform is voltage and current waveforms are supposed to be purely sinusoidal, but that is not the case nowadays. If you try to see the voltage waveform on an oscilloscope, it will be containing harmonic. It will be distorted voltage waveform. And instead of this type of voltage waveform, V0/2π, you may on oscilloscope see this type of voltage waveform. Distorted waveform. Okay, so this type of waveform is having distortions. Okay, distortions are because of harmonics, interharmonics, and notches. And again, there may be DC offset in the voltage. This voltage has no DC offset, but this voltage has DC offset because positive area is more than negative area. So it is shifted towards positive side, okay, towards, so it will have some average value. Otherwise, an AC waveform is defined as a waveform whose average value is zero. But if there is a shift, so above or below, then it will not have average value equal to zero. It may have either a positive average voltage value or it may have a negative average value. Okay, so that is about shift or DC bias. The voltage waveform may have a voltage this bias also. That will also create problems for the operation of the equipments. And then voltage imbalance or voltage unbalance. Voltage imbalance. If you see the three-phase voltages, your three-phase voltages should be perfectly balanced voltages. In terms of amplitudes, all the three voltages, say VA, VB, VC, they should be equal in amplitude. phase difference should be 120 degrees with respect to each other, and their frequency should also be same, 50 hertz each. But there may be your voltage waveform, three phase voltage waveform may not be perfectly balanced. It may have magnitude unbalance, it may have frequency unbalance, or it may have phase unbalance. And because of these unbalances, the end user equipment, especially the three phase motors, they are going to suffer. We'll study that. Okay, that was about voltage unbalance, waveform distortion also we have, and finally voltage flicker. Voltage flicker. Flickering in the voltage, I mean the voltage is varying rapidly. One is voltage dips and it remains there for a longer time and then it comes back to normal value. Another is voltage voltage fluctuation. Voltage fluctuation means change in the voltage. Voltage is changing rapidly. Say it was 230 volts RMS, now it goes 240. Then immediately it comes to 170. Then immediately it goes to, just something like this. For some time it is having normal value and then it dips. And then it comes back to normal value and then it dips. So there is a drop in the voltage and then voltage comes back to normal value and then it drops again. So these rapid variations in the voltage are called voltage fluctuations, and voltage fluctuations give rise to light flicker. I mean, if you use incandescent lamp, jisko hum bulb kehte hai, 100 watt ka bulb, which we used to have in olden days, some 10 years back or few years back, we were using those incandescent lamps, and those incandescent lamps were very, very sensitive to these voltage variations, and their light intensity was frequently changing. And that was causing a lot of irritation. If you were reading some book, you would definitely get irritated. Okay, so that's called voltage flicker. We'll see its effect on end use equipment also. So these are various types of power quality problems whose impact on end user we are going to discuss. So let us discuss it in the form of a table. The first column of table is power quality, type of power quality problem. This is the first column. The second column is category. Category. If there is a power quality problem, what is the category of this power quality problem? The third column is method of characterization. I will explain it. Method of characterization. And fourth column is typical causes. What are the causes, typical causes of a particular type of power quality problem? Okay, so let us discuss these power quality problems one by one. So first power quality problem is transients. I will write here transients. Now there are two types of transients. Number one, impulsive transient, and number two, oscillatory transient. Now as far as this it is impulsive transient. As far as this impulsive transient is concerned, the method of characterization is in terms of peak magnitude, peak magnitude, rise time and duration. And second type of transient, the cause is, typical cause is lightning strike. Please hold on, let me write and then I will explain. Lightning strike. Transformer energization capacitor switching. So that is what. Second type of transient is oscillatory transient. I will write here oscillatory transient. And method of characterization is peak magnitude and frequency components. Frequency components. And the typical causes are impulsive transient. And impulsive transient may result in oscillatory transient. I will discuss it with you. Hold on. Impulsive transient, line, load, and capacitor switching. Capacitor switching. Okay, so this is first type of power quality problem or power quality disturbance, that is transients. Now there may be two types of transients. One is called impulsive transient, another is called oscillatory transient. An impulsive transient looks like this. Let me first of all draw. It may look like this. Suddenly an impulse, a surge in the voltage is there. So this is the normal voltage, and maybe somewhere here a large surge in the voltage, short duration surge is there. That is called impulsive transient. How do we characterize it? In terms of peak magnitude. For example, this voltage peak may be 300 volts, and peak of this transient may be 1000 volts. So this transient may be of the magnitude, peak magnitude of 1000 volts or even more than 1000 volts. So that is how we characterize it. Okay, a transient, a normal voltage may be of the order of a few hundred volts, I mean rated voltage. But whenever a voltage surge or impulsive transient comes, that its amplitude may go as high as thousands of volts. So therefore we characterize it in terms of peak magnitude and rise time. I mean, this is the rise time. The rise time may be fast or it may be slow. It may rise slowly or it may rise fast. It depends. And third is duration. Duration means for how much time it will be there on your system. So this is how we characterize an impulsive transient. And the question is, what is the cause of this impulsive transient? Lightning strike. Transmission line is there. It is exposed to forces of Mother Nature. And this transmission line is struck by a lightning. There's a lightning strike. A lightning strike causes impulsive transients. Another cause may be transformer energization. You are switching on a large transformer suddenly, and that energization of transformer in presence of other components of the power system like capacitances, etc., it may result in impulsive transient. And third is capacitor switching. You have a capacitor bank. As soon as you turn it on, and it may result in impulsive transient. Now, second type of transient is oscillatory transient. Let me show you oscillatory transient. Oscillatory transient is something like this. There's a small peak and then there are oscillations like this. It's oscillatory in nature. There are high frequency oscillations. If I draw it again, maybe like this, and then something like this. It's called oscillatory transient. Now this oscillatory transient is characterized in terms of peak magnitude. You have to find its peak and also frequency components, because once it goes to some peak magnitude, then there are oscillations. What is the frequency of these oscillations? That also, whenever we measure oscillatory transients, we must know the frequency of oscillations also. And what are the causes? An impulsive transient may result in oscillatory transient sometimes. There may be an impulsive transient because of lightning strike or because of transformer energization or because of capacitor switching, and that may immediately result in oscillatory transient. Or other causes may be line switching, load switching, or capacitor switching. So these are the various typical causes for oscillatory transient. Now, as far as this impulsive transient is concerned, the silver lining or the good thing with impulsive transient is there that it does not travel far away from its point of origin. Like, for example, if this is the transmission line and somewhere, say, impulsive transient has come, lightning strike has come, and it has resulted in impulsive transient at a particular place. The good thing is that this impulsive transient does not propagate far away from its point of origin. It remains confined to its point of origin. So therefore, it is not of, it does not cause any damage. It does not propagate forward. But the problem with this impulsive transient is that this impulsive transient may result in oscillatory transient. And these oscillatory transients, they travel. These oscillatory transients, since they travel, they are, if you have a line, they are on the entire line. They appear on the line. And then you have line insulators. The transmission line is having, it's supported by insulators. And because of these oscillatory transients, which are actually over voltages, the insulators, line insulators may get damaged. They may get punctured. Impulsive transient does not propagate. It does not travel far away from its point of origin, but it may result in oscillatory transient. And this oscillatory transient may result in damage to line insulators. So this is the impact of first type of power quality problem, that is transients on the system. It may result in an oscillatory transient may result in damage to line insulators, and also it may result in system resonance. Now, what is the cause of this impulsive transient or oscillatory transient, or what is the cause of transients? One is the natural cause, Mother Nature, lightning strike. But other is the transformer energization and capacitor switching, which is usually done at the substations. You connect, you switch on a capacitor bank at a substation, and that may result in a temporary transient. Okay, so cause may be man-made or it may be natural cause. So this was first type of power quality problem, that is transients and their impact or its impact on the system. Second is short duration voltage variations. Short duration voltage variations. There may be variations or changes in the line voltage, the voltage which is fed to the equipment, but these voltages may be short duration voltages. These voltage variations may be short duration voltage variations, like voltage sag, or you can also call it voltage dip. It's also called sag or dip. Another is voltage swell. Voltage swell. And third is temporary interruption. Temporary interruption. So these are three categories of short duration voltage variations. They come under this column, category. First category of short duration voltage variation is voltage sag or voltage dip. Second is voltage swell. And third is temporary interruption. What is the method of characterization as far as voltage sag is concerned? It is characterized in terms of magnitude and duration. Magnitude, comma, duration. I mean, when there is a dip in the voltage, how much dip? Is it 10% dip, 20% dip, 15% dip? So that gives magnitude of the dip. And then duration. Duration means for how many milliseconds or for how many cycles it is there. So whenever you study the voltage dips or voltage sags, so these two points are very important. What is the magnitude of the sag and what is the duration of the sag? This is how we characterize them. As far as this voltage sag is concerned, what causes voltage dip? You have seen in previous lecture, I have already told you that when large motors are started without any starter, they cause temporary voltage dips or voltage sags. So first cause is motor starting. When I say motor starting, it does not mean small fan motor starting. It means large, huge motor starting. Motor starting, it results in voltage sags. Okay, load switching. Suddenly you are switching on a large, huge load on the system. That may also result in voltage sag. Okay, and then ferromagnetic transformer. Ferromagnetic transformers also cause voltage dips or sags, and then line to ground faults. So you have a line, you have three phase line. One of the line is grounded. When this line is grounded, obviously the voltage of this particular line will dip. But this line to ground fault may get cleared after a few cycles, and then voltages, you know, it comes back to its normal value. Okay, so motor starting, load switching, ferromagnetic transformer, and line to ground faults, they may give rise to voltage sag. What about voltage swell? Before I go to discuss voltage swell, let me first of all discuss the effect of or impact of voltage sag on consumers. I have already discussed it in previous lecture. I will again repeat. Whenever there is a voltage dip or a voltage sag, it may result in loss of production. Okay, because the motor, the contactor of the adjustable speed drive or motor may get opened, the motor may stop, the motor may trip, or the controller of the motor may malfunction because of this voltage sag. Whenever there is voltage sag, the controller maloperates, and it results in stopping of the process. Or the motor may trip itself because of this voltage sag. It may trip. Okay. When the motor trips, the entire industrial process stops. I have given you one example of semiconductor manufacturing. Semiconductor manufacturing plots are very sensitive to these voltage sags. Whenever there is a voltage sag, the motor stops, the entire controller stops, motor stops, and the whole batch of semiconductor devices which were under the process, they get ruined, they get damaged. And it has a significant impact on semiconductor manufacturing plants. And it also has a very bad impact on food processing industries. Because in food processing industries, you use a raw material, you have already invested on raw material, and whenever there is a voltage dip, your motor, your process stops, and there is loss of production. The whole thing, the entire raw material gets wasted. So therefore, it results in loss worth thousands and thousands, hundreds and thousands of dollars, and or I would like to say it results in loss worth millions of dollars every year, these voltage sags. Okay, so voltage sags are very detrimental. They result in loss of production. Simply, they result in loss of production and hence loss of revenue. Let us come to voltage swell. Voltage swell is also characterized in terms of magnitude and duration. Voltage swell means increase in the voltage. Say, for example, your feeder, 11 kV feeder, line-to-line voltage is 11 kV, but sometimes it goes from 11 kV to say 11.5 kV or 12 kV. There may be an increase in the voltage because of certain reasons, so that results in voltage swell. That's called voltage swell. Increase in the voltage from the normal value, above the normal value. Voltage sag is called dip in the voltage. Voltage swell is increase in the voltage for certain period. Okay. Now this swell in the voltage may be for just 5% swell or 10% swell or 15% swell or 20% swell. But let me tell you, voltage swells are not so common in the system as voltage sags. Sags are frequent in the system. Swells are not frequent. But whenever there is swell, what will this swell do? The swell will result in loss of, it will also result in loss of production. Let me give you the reasons of voltage swell. The main reason of voltage swell is switching, capacitor switching, capacitor switching. Another reason is ferromagnetic transformer, and another reason is single line to ground fault, L to G fault. You must have studied in your power system course, you have a three phase line. If one of the line gets grounded, then the voltage of other two lines rises. Okay, the voltage of that particular phase falls because of line to ground fault. But if this line to ground fault is there for a longer duration, it results in a rise in the voltage of healthy phases, other phases, and hence it results in voltage swell. Single line to ground fault results in voltage, it may result in voltage swell. So these are the causes. Now, what is the impact of voltage swell? The impact of voltage swell is that you cannot afford to give a high voltage across your equipment because that may damage your equipment. So therefore, what you do, you put an over voltage protection circuit for your equipment. And whenever there is a voltage swell, this protective circuit trips your motor. It trips your load from the source so that there is no damage done to the load. And therefore, when it trips the motor, it trips the load, there is again loss of production. Just like voltage swell results in loss of production, voltage sag results in loss of production, voltage swell will also result in loss of production because of operation of protective device and tripping of the load. Another problem because of voltage swell is that it may cause stress, voltage stress or over voltage stress on equipments. Okay, because this voltage swell is there, it is an over voltage, so it may cause stress over the equipments. Like there may be very sensitive electronic equipments, and there may be voltage stress across those equipments. And because of if the voltage stress is very large, they may get even damaged. So that is about short duration voltage variations. Let us quickly go to third type, that is long duration voltage variations. Next is long duration voltage variations. Long duration voltage variations are categorized as under voltage, over voltage, and third is sustained interruption. Have I discussed the impact of temporary interruption? I have missed that. That is another category of short duration. I have discussed two categories of short duration voltage variations, the voltage sag and voltage swell, and its impact on the end user equipment. I have forgotten to discuss the short, the temporary interruption. Temporary interruption means disruption of the voltage. There is no voltage. Sag means decrease in the voltage, but voltage is available across the load. Interruption means zero voltage, nearly zero voltage across the load. The temporary interruption may be there for a few cycles, maybe a few milliseconds, but it will result in loss of production because whenever there is this temporary interruption, I should have written there, you can add it there, temporary interruption. It's not a part of this, it's part of previous, I'm writing it here, temporary interruption, method of characterization and cause. Cause is temporary faults. Temporary self-clearing faults. Please do not mix it with this long duration. This is not a part of long duration voltage variation. This is part of short duration voltage variation. I have forgotten to discuss. I am discussing it. It is in continuation with short duration voltage variation. Temporary interruption may be because of temporary faults. Like a tree branch has fallen on the line. And when tree branch falls on the line, it causes grounding of the line. And when after some time tree branch falls down, the fault is automatically cleared. Right? There may be many other causes of temporary faults. A temporary fault results in temporary interruption. And whenever there is interruption, there is loss of production. The entire, your motor, shuts down, your controller shuts down, and there is loss of production. Now this temporary interruption has same effect as voltage sag. Voltage sag also results in loss of production. Temporary interruption also results in loss of production, but temporary interruption is more dangerous than voltage sag. Because in case of voltage sag is there for a few cycles. After a few cycles, voltage is restored. And when voltage is restored, your process again starts, restarts. But in case of temporary interruption, whenever there is temporary interruption, there is loss of production, the process does not restart, okay, automatically. You have to manually restart it. So that takes a lot of time. So therefore, temporary interruption is more detrimental or more damaging than voltage sags. Now let us quickly go to long duration voltage variation. Long duration voltage variation has three categories: under voltage, over voltage, and sustained interruption. How do we categorize under voltage? Under voltage is categorized as magnitude and duration. Magnitude, duration. What are the typical causes of under voltage? What are the typical causes of under voltage? Switching on of large loads and capacitor de-energization. These may be the causes of under voltage. Under voltage is also a voltage dip, but it is for longer duration. It may be for few seconds or even a minute. It may go up to 1 minute. The voltage dip may be for about 1 minute, few seconds, few milliseconds to about 1 minute. So that's why it comes under the category of long duration voltage variation. Your system may put suddenly a large load. It may switch on a large load on your system. When a large load is put on, it may result in under voltage or capacitor de-energization. You know, in substations we have shunt capacitor banks for voltage improvement. Suddenly some capacitor bank may get de-energized. When capacitor bank gets de-energized, the voltage dips because the capacitor banks improve the voltage profile of the line. But when some capacitor bank is disconnected, it is de-energized, the voltage dips. Okay, that is about under voltage. What is the effect of under voltage? Under voltage has same effect as voltage sag. Voltage sag results in loss of production. Under voltage also results in loss of production and hence loss of revenue. Second is over voltage. Over voltage is also characterized in terms of magnitude and duration. And what is the cause of over voltage? The cause of over voltage is switching off of large loads. Switching off of large loads and capacitor energization. Now suppose a large portion of the load gets disconnected. What will happen? Your generators at the generating station, they will overspeed and they will result in over voltage. And that overvoltage may be for longer period, longer duration. You cannot call that overvoltage voltage swell. Voltage swell is only for a few cycles. Overvoltage may be there for, it is also an increase in the voltage above normal rated value, but it may be there for longer period. Another cause may be capacitor energization. So you are unnecessarily overcompensating your system. You are switching on some capacitor banks which you are not supposed to switch on. So when you are switching on capacitor banks, you are energizing shunt capacitor banks. They inject reactive power into the transmission line or into the line, into the feeder, and they increase the voltage. So these may be the causes of overvoltage. And what are the impacts? Impacts are same. Load is fitted with protection circuit. Protection circuit, whenever there is overvoltage, protection circuit will operate. It will disconnect the load and there is loss of protection. Another problem may be that this overvoltage is there, it may damage, it may put stress on various electronic equipments. Voltage, it will increase the voltage stress, and some of the equipments may even get damaged because of high voltage. Third is sustained interruption. Sustained interruption means interruption for a long period, and sustained interruption causes faults. Okay? The line has got tripped because of some fault. So when the line trips, there is sustained interruption. And this sustained interruption, again, results in complete blackout and loss of production and loss of revenue. So this was about third type of power quality problem, that is long duration voltage variations and It has three categories: under voltage, over voltage, and sustained interruption. I have given you the typical causes for all the three and their impact on the system. Next is voltage imbalance. Next is voltage imbalance or voltage unbalance. Okay, now this voltage imbalance does not have any category, and method of characterization is magnitude, symmetrical components. Symmetrical components, and the causes may be, typical causes may be single phase loads and single phasing. You have to understand the difference between the two. What is voltage imbalance? So your system, three phase system, is said to be balanced if it delivers a three phase voltage whose all the three phase voltages or line voltages, they are having equal magnitude, equal amplitude, and they are displaced with respect to each other by 120 degrees, and they are having same frequency. If the magnitude is same, frequency is same, phase angle is 120 degrees each, then the system is said to be a balanced system. But because of certain reasons, sometimes your voltage, which is fed to a three-phase motor, it becomes unbalanced voltage or imbalanced voltage. What causes imbalance or unbalance in the voltage is single-phase loads. So you have a three-phase system like this. You have a three-phase four-wire system. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is phase A, phase R, phase Y, phase B, and this is neutral. Three-phase load is directly fed from this R by B, and single-phase loads are connected between some loads between phase R and neutral, some loads between phase Y and neutral, and some loads between phase B and neutral. This is how our domestic load is fed. In my home, I get a single phase supply. I may get from phase R with respect to neutral, or I may get, some other houses may get single phase supply from phase Y with respect to neutral. Some other houses in my colony, they may get single phase supply from phase B with respect to neutral. Now it is possible that the distribution of single phase loads on three phase four wire system is not balanced. Normally, all the single phase loads should have been balanced. I mean, if this is 50 kilowatt load, total single phase load, this should also be 50 kilowatt, this should also be 50 kilowatt. It will load all the three lines equally, but that is not always true. It may be possible that this load is 50 kilowatt, and this load is, say, 60 kilowatt, and this load may be only 30 kilowatts. So there is unbalance. Single phase loads are not of equal magnitude. So this causes unbalance in the load. So your load is unbalanced, and this load unbalance results in unbalance in the voltages. So the three phase voltages which are fed to three phase motors, they become unbalanced. Some voltage has higher magnitude, some voltages have low magnitudes. The magnitude or amplitude of all the three phase voltages are not same, they are not equal. So this is called voltage imbalance. Single phasing is another. Single phase load means is your, this example, you are not equally uniformly distributing single phase loads on the three lines. That may cause voltage imbalance or voltage unbalance. Another reason may be single phasing. You must have studied single phasing in your induction machines. Your induction machine is a three phase machine. Suddenly one of the phases is blown, it's off, and your machine gets only two phases. So it is fed from two phases, one phase is not working. That is called single phasing. That also results in voltage unbalance. So therefore, what is the impact of voltage unbalance on the system? Voltage unbalance, when an unbalanced three phase voltage is fed to a three phase induction motor or to a three phase synchronous motor, there is a lot of heating in the windings of the motors. The motor windings get heated up, the motor produces more heat, more temperature rise, which shortens the life of motor, and efficiency of the motor decreases. So to overcome the overheating of the motor, what you do, you have to derate your motor. You derate. That means if your motor was rated for X horsepower, you have to run it at Y horsepower, where Y is less than X. This is called derating of the motors. So if unbalanced voltage is fed to a three-phase motor, three-phase AC motor, the motor heats up, its efficiency decreases, and you may have to go for derating of the motor. Okay, this is about voltage unbalance. Next is, this was fourth power quality problem. Next is waveform distortion. Fifth one is waveform distortion. Now there may be three categories of waveform distortion. One is harmonics, another is notches, and another is DC bias. Okay, DC offset. Now, how do you characterize harmonics? Harmonics are characterized as THD, total harmonic distortion, and harmonic spectrum. Notches are also characterized similarly, ditto. That is THD and harmonic spectrum. And DC offset is characterized in terms of voltage and current. Let us study them one by one. Harmonics. Harmonics means these are additional, you know, sinusoidal waveforms which are superimposed on the fundamental frequency waveform. Your waveform is at 50 hertz, fundamental waveform. Okay, say 230 volts, 50 hertz, or 11 kV, 50 volts, 50 hertz. Then there are harmonics superimposed on it. There may be many causes of harmonics. I will come to that in future classes. What causes harmonics in the voltage? What causes harmonics in the current? And because of these harmonics, the waveform gets distorted. I mean, if your waveform, your voltage waveform should have been purely sinusoidal, like this, with fundamental amplitude as fundamental value as V1, 0 to say 2 pi. But what happens? It may be superimposed with third harmonic. This is also a sinusoidal wave, but its frequency is 3 times the fundamental frequency. Let me call this V3, third harmonic. Why it is called third harmonic? Because its frequency is 3 times the fundamental frequency. See, for one cycle of fundamental, it how many cycles it covers? 1, 2, 3. So that's why it's called third harmonic. Similarly, this waveform may have fifth harmonic, it may have seventh harmonic, it may have ninth harmonic, 11th harmonic. So when you add these waveforms, I mean fundamental waveform and harmonic, various harmonics, your voltage waveform gets distorted. It may become something like this. Distorted waveform, V. It may become distorted. Okay? So therefore, harmonics are integral multiples of fundamental frequency. Like this is third harmonic, its frequency is 3 times fundamental. Fifth harmonic has a frequency of 5 times fundamental. Seventh harmonic has a frequency of 7 times fundamental, and so on. Now, in addition to harmonics, there are subharmonics. Subharmonics have a frequency which is the fraction of the fundamental. I mean, what is your fundamental frequency? 50 hertz. There may be some harmonics in the waveform whose frequency is less than 50 hertz. Such harmonics are called subharmonics. And third types of harmonics are called interharmonics. Interharmonics are also harmonics, additional unwanted waveforms which are superimposed on fundamental frequency waveform, but their frequency is not integral multiple of fundamental. Like, what is the frequency of third harmonic? It is 3 times fundamental. What is the frequency of fifth harmonic? 5 times fundamental. Interharmonic may not be 3 times, it may be 3.5 times fundamental. It may be 3.2 times fundamental. So interharmonics are those harmonics which are not integral multiples of fundamental. So therefore, we have identified three types of distortions in the waveform, three types of harmonics. One is called harmonics. Harmonics have frequency which are integral multiple of fundamental frequency. This is one example. Interharmonics have the frequency which is not integral multiple of fundamental frequency. And then subharmonics have a frequency less than fundamental frequency. And all these types of harmonics, they cause distortion in the voltage, and your final voltage waveform, which is available across your load, it is not sinusoidal, it is non-sinusoidal, it is distorted, and it causes a lot of problems. Now, when these harmonic currents flow through the distribution system, they flow through the motor windings, they flow through the transformer windings, they are additional frequency components. Actually, only 50 Hertz fundamental should have been there. But in addition to 50 Hertz fundamental, there are harmonics also. So these harmonics cause increased or additional copper losses, I square R losses in the distribution system, that is feeder and conductors. They cause additional harmonic losses, power losses in motor windings, in transformer windings. And they result in heating and hence reduction or decrease in the efficiency of the machine. And you may have to derate your machine. Okay, that is about harmonics. And harmonics have other side effects also, like these harmonics cause electromagnetic interference, and they cause interference with communication networks, with telephone circuits. If you have a power line, this is power line, this is power line, and this is telephone line. If currents in this power line are having harmonics, then they interfere with the nearby telephone line or communication line, and they cause lot of noise in these telephone lines or communication lines. They also interfere with air traffic control system. Okay, so they cause a lot of problems in the system. So what are the typical causes of harmonics? Harmonics are mainly caused by adjustable speed drives, ASDs, and non-linear loads. Adjustable speed drives means induction motor drives which are fed from inverter, variable frequency inverter. And these variable frequency inverters have front end AC to DC converter which cause harmonic distortion, which draw harmonic rich currents from the source, and they cause harmonic distortion. So that is about harmonics and their impact on the end users or on the customers. I've already told you harmonic currents cause additional heating in the distribution system, in the induction motors, in the synchronous motors, in the transformers, and hence they decrease the efficiency, and you may have to derate all these equipments for controlling the temperature. And they also cause electromagnetic interference and interference with communication systems. That's about harmonics. What about notches? Notch is something like this. This is your voltage waveform. Suddenly there may be one notch here, and there may be another notch here. These are called notches. I don't know, I suppose that you have already been taught it in your BTEC power electronics course. In three-phase converters, during the commutation overlap, because of the presence of leakage inductance or inductance, source inductance, the transfer of current or commutation of current takes some time. Okay, that time is called commutation overlap angle or commutation overlap time. And during that commutation overlap time, the line voltage produces notches. This is the commutation overlap period, U degree overlap period. Phase voltages do not have notches. There is reduction in the phase voltages, but line voltages will have notches like this. And these notches also, you can see when a voltage waveform, this line voltage waveform should have been like this, but it is not like this. It's having a notch here. So therefore it gets distorted because of these notches. And what are the causes of these notches? Power electronic converters, AC to DC converters, three-phase converters, you can say. They are responsible for these notches. And these notches also result in distortion in the voltage, and they result in, they cause problems. Third is DC offset. DC offset means, I mean, your current waveform should have been like this, or voltage waveform should have been like this, but it is like this. So positive area is more than negative area, or it may be like this. Positive area less than negative area. So this has a positive DC shift, this has a negative DC shift. So that's called DC offset. So it is characterized in terms of voltage and current, because this DC offset means offset in the voltage or offset in the current. And what is the cause? Cause is, there is one phenomenon, natural phenomenon, that is called geomagnetic disturbance. Geomagnetic disturbance is one cause, which is a natural cause, and another cause, which is man-made cause, is half wave rectifiers. Those of you who have studied half wave rectifiers very deeply, and they have understood the operation of single phase half wave rectifier or three phase half wave rectifier, a half wave rectifier draws current only during the positive half cycle, not during negative half cycle. So therefore, since it draws current only during the positive half cycle, the transformer which feeds the rectifier carries DC component of current only, and that results in DC offset. And this DC offset, when this type of current, I mean, when voltage is not, you know, symmetric voltage, it has got some offset, and when this type of voltage is fed to a three-phase motor, and this DC offset causes additional heating in the motor, it causes saturation of core, magnetic core of the motor. It causes saturation in the core of transformer. In case of a single phase half wave rectifier, the current, the voltage waveform is like this. And if this is your source voltage Vs, the current is like this. The current flows only during the positive half cycles. And if your rectifier is fed through a transformer, your transformer is not carrying AC current, because during the negative half cycle, there is no current coming from the supply. It's a half wave rectifier. Your converter draws current only during the positive half cycle. So what type of current your transformer is carrying? It's DC current. So therefore, your transformer gets saturated. So therefore, DC offset causes saturation of transformers and motors. And finally, the last type of power quality problem and its impact on consumers that we are going to discuss today is voltage flicker. I will discuss all these power quality problems in more details, inshallah, in next lecture, but here I'm giving a brief overview of these problems. Now this voltage flicker is characterized in terms of frequency of occurrence and modulating method of characterization is frequency of occurrence and modulating frequency. What is, you have to first of all understand what voltage flicker is. Voltage flicker is rapid variations in the voltage. Its another name is voltage pulsation. It's the change in voltage, increase and decrease in voltage, but very, very rapid. Voltage increases and suddenly it decreases after a few milliseconds or after a few seconds. And then it increases again, decreases again. And if you are reading a newspaper or a book under a fluorescent lamp or an incandescent lamp, these frequent variations in the voltage will result in flickering in the lamp light. The light of the lamp will flicker and it will cause a lot of irritation. So it is an aggravating rapid on-off sensation as perceived by human eye. When you look at the lamp is flickering. Its intensity of light is changing very frequently, I mean very rapidly, because of these rapid voltage changes, voltage flickers. It causes light flicker. And this light flicker causes, you know, it shortens the life of fluorescent lamp, and it may damage the television circuits, and it may cause problems to other equipments, and above all, it results in health hazard. What health hazard? For example, there are a number of workers or laborers are working in a factory, and so then there is a, you know, this voltage flickering is there. They are working with machines, and this voltage flickering will cause sensation, you know, visual sensation, you know, the flickering sensation as perceived by human brain. And this continuous flickering of the light will result in irritation, headache, and migraine. It has been found that factory workers have suffered from health hazards like headaches and migraines because of this light flickering. When the light flickers because of these voltage fluctuations, then it results in irritation in their eyes. It results in migraine. It results in headaches. Okay, and the efficiency of the work of the workers, it decreases. Their efficiency goes down, and it ultimately tells upon the output of the factory, output of the industry. So therefore, voltage flicker basically means voltage fluctuation, rapid variations in the voltage. It results in light flicker. Flicker in the light bulb and flicker in the TV screen, and it results in irritation, headache, and migraine. Now, what is the cause of voltage flicker or light flicker? The causes are use of arc discharge lamps, electric arc lamps or arc discharge lamps. A few years back, we were using those sodium vapor lamps. They are arc lamps, and arc furnaces arc welding equipment rapidly cycling load and adjustable speed drive with insufficient DC link filtering. These are various causes of flicker. Arc discharge lamps, sodium vapor lamps, etc. They cause voltage fluctuations and hence light flicker. Electric arc furnaces, they are based on arc. Whenever arc is struck between the two electrodes, voltage dips, and then when arc goes, voltage comes back to normal. And then again, arc is there, voltage dips, arc goes, voltage. So there is, you know, continuously that arc striking and arc extinguishing, and that results in, you know, frequent or rapid variations in the voltage and flicker in the light. Then another is electric arc welding. Arc welding also is responsible. Another is rapidly cycling load. There is a load which is cycling. Cycling means changing. Sometimes it is increasing and then suddenly it decreases. And then it increases again, decreases. Increase in load results in voltage dip, and decrease in load results in voltage rise. So if the load is rapidly changing, cycling, and it results in voltage fluctuations and hence light flickering. And another cause which I am going to discuss in next class, hopefully, is adjustable speed drives with insufficient DC link filtering. I will discuss it there. That also is responsible for voltage fluctuations and hence light flicker. And impact is this light flicker or voltage fluctuation or voltage flicker will affect some of the equipment. It will shorten the life of fluorescent lamps. It will affect the TV screen. I mean TV, that your TV life may get shortened, television life may get shortened. And above all, it causes health hazards. It causes irritation in the eyes, it causes headaches and migraines. So these were various types of power quality problems, their categories, method of characterization and causes, and impact on end user equipment. So summarizing what we have learned in today's lecture, we have first of all defined what is a power quality problem, and we have discussed various, some six types of power quality problems with their, you know, categories, method of characterization, typical causes, and impact on end user equipment. To begin with, we first discussed transients. I told you that there are two types of transients. One is impulsive transient, another is oscillatory transient. Impulsive transient may not create much problem because it does not travel far from its point of origin, but it may result in oscillatory transient, which may cause puncture or failure of blind insulators. Okay, and then we have discussed what are the causes of these transients. Second type of power quality problem that we discussed was short duration voltage variations, and various categories: voltage sag, voltage swell, short temporary interruption. I told you that voltage sag, voltage swell, or these temporary interruptions, etc., they result in loss of production, loss of revenue, and we have discussed what are the causes also. And then third type of power quality problem was long duration voltage variation: under voltage, over voltage, and sustained interruption. And their causes also we have discussed, and they result, they also result in loss of production and loss of revenue. And that was third. Fourth type we discussed was voltage imbalance or voltage unbalance. We discussed causes, and voltage unbalance, I told you that it results in additional heating in motors, AC motors, and hence you may have to derate your motors. Then we discussed next problem, which was waveform distortion. Harmonics, interharmonics, subharmonics, they result in, you know, distortion in the voltages, and hence there's harmonics, they result in additional losses in distribution system, motor windings, transformer windings. They also result in electromagnetic interference and interference with communication systems, telephone lines. Okay, interharmonics affect various equipments like electronic circuits. They affect the performance of electronic circuits, and subharmonics result in additional heating in the motors, motor windings. And then notches and DC offset. I told you that notches also result in distortion in the voltage, and DC offset results in saturation in transformer core. And finally, last type of power quality problem that we discussed was voltage flicker or voltage fluctuation, which results in light flicker. And I told you what are the causes. These are the causes. And it affects the human health, and it also affects various types of equipments. So with this, I will end my today's lecture. I hope that you will go through this lecture. And I was very happy the other day, yesterday and today, you put a lot of queries, and I was very pleased to answer your queries. That shows your, you know, enthusiasm in learning this subject. That shows your curiosity to learn the subject. I hope that you will keep on interacting with me like this. I will be very, very pleased to answer your queries, clear your doubts. Please go through this lecture, video lecture. In case there are any queries, interact with me on the WhatsApp group or any other mode you can use. You can even call me. I'll be pleased to clear your doubts, interact with you, and discuss various concepts, clear your doubts. Thank you very much.